Now, God is good, but man is not. And I really, you know, this is where, again, this is where we actually take it right to the razor's edge between, you know, on that dividing line between what is marriage and what is not. Sadly, rape comes closest to actually being marriage without being marriage, if that makes any sense to you. It comes about as close as you can get to marriage without actually being married. It's because it's incomplete. It's incomplete in as much as she did not give herself to that man. So she did not really join to that man. And the Bible says that, you know, there is a joining. Now his flesh joined to her flesh, but she did not join with him. It was forced upon her. And we see that the Bible says that that sort of thing should be handled much like murder is handled. That man should not even be allowed to live, says the Bible. Okay? That's what the Bible says. Not me, not Ed King. Okay? That's what the Bible says. Now, if you don't want to accept what the Bible says, well, you take it up with the Lord. You know, people say, well, that's Old Testament. Well, no, I'm going to tell you something, friend. Are you ready? Brace yourselves. Are you ready? That's God's moral law. I said that's God's moral law. Okay? This is not a Levirate law or a Levite law or a dietary law. Okay? You know, it's not one of those laws contained in the commandments and ordinances of the Levite priesthood. No. This applied to all. This was one of God's moral laws that rapists should be executed. All right? And if Christians, so-called, I have to say that because I don't see a lot of Christians anymore these days. If Christians want to argue that, oh, well, a man should have short hair, shouldn't have long hair, because that's God's moral law. Well, you see, they're arguing from the Old Testament when they say that. Paul argued from the Old Testament when he made that declaration concerning the length of hair on a man, by the way. If Christians want to argue this is not one of those laws contained in the ordinances of the Levitical priesthood, they lose. They lose. Okay? They can't use that sort of approach, because this is not one of those laws, dietary laws or laws concerning Sabbaths and new moons and things like that. Okay, this is not a priesthood law. This is a moral law. So here is what the Christian has to do. The Christian man and woman has to judge in themselves. Am I going to abide by God's moral law, or does God's moral law apply to me anymore? And if the answer is yes, then they are obligated to agree that rapists should be executed, because God's moral law says so. That's God's moral law. I do think that it really does have to be proven beyond a shadow of doubt that a man is raped. Just because they find his DNA in that woman does not necessarily constitute rape. I think that, you know, that man has to be caught in the very act. I think that there actually has to be witnesses. You know, that's why further on it'll also talk about, and if they be found, right? You know, Because any woman can seduce a man into copulating with her and then turn around and say that he raped her. It takes a lot of very intensive investigating to prove a rape. Now, I'm not saying it can't be done, because I believe it can be done. Today, we have lie detector tests. Today, we have special medical procedures which can prove, because when a woman fights back, her body behaves differently, okay? And that can actually be found medically when she's fought back, when she's resisted her attacker. That can be proven medically. And of course, we have DNA. So, if they're not found, and there's enough evidence to substantiate that a rape has likely taken place. Okay, in other words, proof that she tried to fight back, that she tried to protect herself from that man. The DNA, okay? All these, you know, things that indicate that a rape was indeed occurring, but nobody had found them. I think there should be some severe penalty at least. And I mean a severe penalty. Okay, put him in jail for 20 years. Why? Because even if it was not rape, what's he doing messing with a woman like that? What's he doing messing with a woman like that? All right? At least he still has his life. They haven't killed him. Probably not much of a life being in jail for 20 years. People get less than that these days for murder. It's sick. It's sick. Okay? My friend, God's moral law does not change. I guess that's what I want to conclude with. And we need to start going back to the law. We need to actually look at what God calls sinful, what God calls unacceptable, what God calls an abomination. We have to start bringing back some laws here. We have to start looking at what God's moral law is. Because, you know, if these so-called Christians are saying, no, a guy can't walk around dressed in a bra and panties and presenting himself in public in women's clothing, that's not Christian. Well, you're going to have to show me in the Bible where it says that, and what you're going to do is you're going to turn to God's moral law. That's what you're going to do, Mr. Christian, Mrs. Christian. And if you're going to do that, then I want you to know that I just turned to God's moral law and showed you where the Bible says that rapists should be executed. That's God's moral law. There you go. And no, this isn't marriage. This comes about as close to marriage as it can get when a child is born of rape. Okay? It's a half marriage, if you will. And it was thrust upon her, forced upon her. It's really a sad thing when rape occurs. I have wrestled with this. And I'm going to get personal about this. I wrestled with this because I was falsely accused of rape about 35 years ago. And so it's a very personal, touchy issue for me. And I know that if it was tried properly in a court of law, that they would discover that no such rape occurred. Okay, it never got to law. Thank God it didn't go before a magistrate. They probably would have crucified me. But that woman went around telling people that I had raped her. And I was very young, early 20s. And when it got back to me, I was shocked and appalled. It was a good wake-up call for me. Because women really do this. Women will receive you. Young men, I'm hoping you're listening. Women will receive you, and then later on, they'll say, he raped me, okay? I still remember the event. And, wow, you know? So I just want to make it clear here, you know? Women will do that to you, young men. And I think real rapists, you know, they should be dealt with. They should be well dealt with. And I am not going to feel bad, you know, if a rapist is caught in the very act and somehow loses his life as a result of that. I have four daughters. And the first daughter, I warned her and prepared her for this sort of thing. And I mean to prepare the next three too. And she's, you know, she's well prepared, but the eldest one, she is well prepared for rape, okay? She knows what to do. I don't mess around on this subject, okay? Either, you know, you can't pussyfoot around this, all right? If a Christian is going to say that God's moral law does not change, then they better be prepared to embrace all of God's moral law or drop it. Let them return to greasy grace and see how far that gets them. Those who are living in grace, they shouldn't be concerned. They're not going to break God's moral law. They're living in grace. Because people who live in grace live lawfully. They don't live above the law. They don't live under the law. They don't live beside the law. They don't live around the law. No, the law is written in their hearts, and they are in the law, and they establish the law because the law is in them. I hope that's clear. Too many Christians today don't understand law. And as a result, they really don't understand grace. Because when you live under the law of love, you're in grace. And God's moral law is written in your heart. You know when you're doing something wrong. No, I don't make excuses for rapists. And rape is not marriage. God bless you. Thank you so much for listening to my video.